and all the participants to this 13th session of Faculty Development Program on Design and Development of Electric Vehicle, sponsored by AICTE Training and Learning Academy, AICTE, New Delhi. I extend my hearty welcome to all the faculty members of these various institutions. It is a privilege to introduce our great resource person, Mr. Raghunang Chowdhury, Senior Design Engineer, EV, ISIE India, Noida. He has 4 years experience in consultation in EV powertrain and battery design, experts in EV powertrain, selection, battery pack casting design, electric vehicle homologation and testing. He has have knowledge of CAD and design and has briefly worked in robotics and automation designing industrial machine. Currently working as senior design engineer, EV in Imperial Society of Innovative Engineers, ISIE India, Noida. We are glad to have you on this great session, sir. You can start your proceedings. Thank you so much.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay, just a second. I'll be sharing my screen. Yes. The screen is
visible. Yeah, it is visible.
Okay. So, first of all, good morning, everyone, and thank you for this introduction of mine. And today, the topic for my presentation will be component sizing and integration. So, in this, we'll be taking a look at. So, I believe previously in the last 2 to 3 days, some of my colleagues have come up and told you about. On Sunday, Aman, one of my colleagues, he informed me about how to calculate the motor power and torque, right? Then Venkat had informed you about the battery packs and everything, right? So today we'll be going to learn about the component sizing integration. So we know how to calculate like the battery pack size or to how what power of motor do we require and all. But over here in this session, we'll be focusing more on do we require that much power and how, like which kind of motor should we go for? First of all, like if you talk about motor, so which kind of motor should we go for? It's not only about calculating power and the torque, but what kind should we go for and what, which one would be beneficial for us, right? For our application. And apart from that, how these will integrate together, come together to function as a single unit, and as well as like there are certain limiting factor also, right? So like there are certain parameters that limits the power torque. Like if you calculate, you can gain any power or torque value for motor, let's say. So will that be required or what are the limitations from the design point of view? So we'll be taking a look at that, right? So we'll be starting with the motor selection. So in motor selection, let's take a basic look at. So as already my colleagues have as informed, so in case of motors, we have, these are the three major kinds of motors that we are using in case for electric vehicle, right? So we have BLDC motor, permanent magnet synchronous motor, and induction motor. So these three are the different types of motors which we are majorly using. Apart from the exception of Tesla that my colleague Venkat had mentioned yesterday. So they are using PMSRM, right? Switch reluctance motor. Okay. Reluctance motor they are using. But apart from that, most of the companies or manufacturers in the industry are using either of these three motors, which is BLDC motor, PMSM motor, or induction motor, right? So BLDC motor, we know, is basically a motor with, in case of BLDC motor, we have the winding in the stator, magnet in the rotor, and it will be working on DC pulses, right? So the source of the electricity or source of power will be a DC current, right? And it will be working on DC pulses. So we'll be providing DC pulses with varying voltage and current as per the performance required. Then for PMSM motor, again, so this is an AC motor. So over here, we'll be varying the voltage, current, and frequency as per the performance, and same goes for the induction motor. the difference between them is that PMSM motor will be working with at synchronous speeds, right? And it consists of permanent magnet in the rotor, whereas the induction motor will have a squirrel cage rotor, right? And it is an asynchronous motor, basically, right? So these three are the major types of motors. And for these three motors, you yesterday itself, like Venkat had told you about different control methods and all on differences on the basis of that, the electrical, from the electrical point of view, the differences that you have, right? So I'll be discussing the differences on from the application point of view. Application point of view in the sense that, like, if you are developing an electric vehicle, right, and if you are working on that side of the product, and if you want to do the selection, so apart from the electrical point of view, like how much, how you can control it and all, but before that, you need to select the motor which one you want to use. So there, we are more concerned about what is our major goal regarding the vehicle, or what are the limiting parameters regarding the vehicle that we have. For example, there are various parameters on which we design the vehicle, or which we keep in mind while designing the vehicle or working on the vehicle. So the first one would be the cost, right? The weight of the vehicle, the cost of the vehicle, the performance of the vehicle, right? Then the customer, how the customer viewpoint is. So that is more on the design part, right? But these three are the major factors: performance or reliability, you can say. And fourth one will be reliability. So we have reliability, performance, cost and weight, right? So these four are the major factors on which we are deciding the component, or we are designing the components that we are using in the vehicle, right? So on these parameters, if you compare these motors, so this is the comparison that we have on these parameters for these motors. So for BLDC motor, if you see, so BLDC induction and PMSM motor, right? So first of all, let's talk about the efficiency or the performance part of the segment, right? So if you talk about efficiency, so these motors, BLDC motor, induction motor and PMSM motor, so out of this, induction motor, like the maximum efficiency that you can get in induction motor is 90%, right? So out of these three, induction motor is not as efficient, right? Induction motor is the one with least efficiency, right? Which is 90% if you talk about the maximum efficiency, right? But if you talk about the efficiency range, so in that, BLDC is the one with poor performance, right? So like BLDC can give you a maximum efficiency of 95%, but there will be points where the efficiency will be 35% also, right? So BLDC has a very broad efficiency range. It ranges from 35% to 95%, whereas induction has efficiency range from 65% to 90%. Right. And PMSM will have 70% to 98%. So for PMSM, you can go up to 98% as per the design. Like, it depends upon the design of the motor, how well you are configuring the magnets and the how well you are able to control the motor. It will depend on that, obviously. But these three are the different design parameters. So they are the efficiency. Like, if you talk about the efficiency, so these motors, this is the efficiency range for these three motors, right? So traditionally, in case of engines, like for example, in case of engines, we were more concerned about, okay, the engine is having this much power and the maximum power, maximum torque, right? And whatever the efficiency might be, like if you talk in the technical terms or the team which is working on it, right? But over here, when it comes to motors, we are also more concerned about the minimum efficiency. So apart from maximum efficiency, we are also concerned about minimum efficiency. So which for BLDC motor is like, it has a very broad range. Induction motor, although the maximum efficiency is the lowest out of three, but the efficiency range is smaller as compared to BLDC motor. And then you have a PMSM motor, which is having a very good, very narrow efficiency range, as well as the values are also higher than all of them, right? So that is why if you talk about efficiency, then PMSM would be the better one, right? Now, if you talk about the cost. So when it comes to cost, induction motor is the cheapest motor, like the control methods or the whole power electronic system being used in the induction, its programming and all, it comes very cheap because induction motor has been there for a very long time. And people now know efficiently how to operate this motor and everything, right? So, right. So the induction motor has been there for a long time, and it is the cheapest of them all, right? So now keeping that same induction motor as the parameter, if you see, so I have kept induction motor as the parameter of X rupees for say, like for a given power. So BLDC motor is the most costliest with three times the cost. So if induction motor is like, for example, if you take 15 kilowatt, so for 15 kilowatt induction motor will be of around, yeah, 15 kilowatt induction motor will be of 45,000 to 50,000, right? And then for BLDC motor, the same 15 kilowatt motor is 1.5 lakhs. Okay, so straight away three times cost difference is there. And if you come to PMSM motor, so PMSM motor is roughly two times the cost, roughly in the sense that obviously it is slightly higher than that, right? It is 2.1 or 2.2 times the cost it will be, right? But yes, in PMSM comes in between, but the cheapest is induction motor and the costliest is BLDC motor. Then when we come to weight, so you can see that induction motor is the heaviest motor. So again, taking induction motor as a parameter, so taking induction motor as the parameter, so we have heaviest motor X kg. So taking that, so again, BLDC is 0.3 times of X, right? So BLDC is the one which is the lightest, right? And PMSM will be around 0.5X. So, right. So now if you compare these three parameters, so if you want a vehicle, or if you want a motor which is lighter in weight, right, which we obviously want for every case, but if the weight is your major concern, weight and space of the motor is your major concern, so in that case, obviously BLDC motor will be the one which you will prefer, right? And that is why you can see on the basis of application, the two-wheeler vehicles or the three-wheeler vehicles will have BLDC motor mostly, because again, there the space restriction is there and the vehicles are smaller in size, so you need a motor which is lighter in weight. You don't want to use a motor which is three times the weight, like, okay, right? So you want to keep the weight low, and thus in BLDC fits much better in two-wheeler or three-wheeler applications, right? Then it comes the induction motor. Now when it comes to induction motor, so you can see the major advantage of induction motor is that it is cheapest, right? And apart from that, one of the other major advantage of induction motor is it is rugged, right? It can be put through any kind of loadings and everything, and it can bear the variation in like a rapid variation in load, then increasing the torque up to 200%. All these things can be done in induction motor, right? So thus induction motor becomes best for heavy commercial vehicles, right? Because these vehicles are already of very high cost, as well as these vehicles will undergo various operations, and basically the operational requirement of these vehicles demand motor to be abused, right? And induction motor is good at that, as well as cheapest at the same time. So that is why commercial vehicles will have induction motor, right? And then you have permanent magnet synchronous motor. So permanent magnet synchronous motor has a very good efficiency, but apart from that, it is lighter than induction motor and cheaper than BLDC motor, right? So for all these three combinations combined, all these three parameters combined, PMSM motor makes an obvious choice for passenger vehicles. So if you take passenger cars, if you take buses, right, all these things, PMSM motor will make an obvious choice, right? So this is how these three motor selection is there, like these three motors are being used in the industry, right? Or by the manufacturers as per their, you can say USP, right? For these three motors, so each of the, one of them have their own USP. For BLDC, the major USP is of that of weight. For induction, it is for the cost. And for PMSM, it is of the efficiency combined with the other two, right? So it includes best of all the worlds. Right. So that is how it is there. Okay. Right. So this is how, on the basis of these three parameters, we decide which sir, motor to use. Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt, sir. Are you ready to take up some questions now?
Yeah, I can pick up. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, my name is Shiva Kumar from Madurai. So overall, actually, I was able to follow your presentation. I'm seeing some of the two wheelers. I'm seeing some of the electric motors just driving the rear axle. And it was maintaining properly. There is no noise.
So your voice is breaking, so I'm unable to get the whole question. Sorry.
Everything's fine. But when it comes to
Hello?
Sir, we are unable to hear.
So I would say if you could write your question in the chat.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, now you
Hello?
Are. Yes.
Sir, am I
audible? Yeah.
Okay. You are just driven by the electric motors in the rear axle. But when it comes to cost factor, it was so expensive. 80,000 a two-wheeler. So is there any possibilities to bring those two-wheelers to affordable by, you know, other leading motorcycles in the market?
Okay, I got half of the, like, I got the later half of the question that you are asking about, if it is able to, we can
affordability, reduce the cost. Affordability of electric two-wheelers. I'm talking about affordability of electric two-wheelers.
Okay, and on the terms of motors, so I could not get the first half, actually. Again, your voice was breaking. Now your voice is clear. Can you repeat the first half? Like the motor rear axle part, what you were saying.
Motor rear axle part. So being an automobile engineer, I can understand the maintenance and replacing parts. So when it comes to servicing those things, being motor fitted in the rear axle, it is a little bit of constraint in terms of assembling and disassembling those components. But still, when it comes to the commercial point of view, how feasible it is to bring the cost down when it comes to electric two-wheeler. I'm not talking about anything on the four-wheeler, but as far as two-wheelers, because that will have a significant reduction in the emissions, and as well as other advantages are there when it comes to the pipeline. But how do we get more cost, least expensive from the commercial point of view? Is there any possibilities to bring it down?
Okay, so actually, if you'll see, most of the companies, can you give me two more slides? I think in that, after that, I think I'll be able to explain this in much better way.
Sure. Thank you, Lakshmi. Thank you, Lakshmi.
Yeah.
Sir, in this context, I can add, I had one electric motor wheeler, and its speed range is very, very less. Very less.
Yes. I understand. Yeah.
And I was facing too much of difficulty sometimes on road, so that it is speed. Why shouldn't we get a slightly higher speed in this electric vehicle?
I will come to that also. I think it's WebAV, right? So, ma'am, I will come to your question also, and I will come to sir's question also. But just give me two more slides. Yeah. Hello.
But ma'am, statement experience to share. When I was in Bangalore, it is very difficult to travel in a four wheeler, and it is to traffic becomes a lot of hectic peak time. So it is very difficult, because it will take minimum 2.5 to 3 hours from our place. Is to, it will take very small, but luckily I got an opportunity to drive a very small Luna kind of vehicle, but it's an electrically operated vehicle, and it will make my life so better that I can reach the place within 30 minutes. So I just thought of adding some good experience with it, madam. When she said, saying something about it. Yeah, it makes my life so better. You know, it is not at all possible without the vehicle reaching the destination within 30 minutes. So, but I will take a lot of turn and everything will be done. But drivability and other point of view, I was so happy about using those vehicles. So, yeah. So, to your point,
I will just like to add that whenever I visit Bangalore, like thanks to like 2 years ago, I think the bounce came into Bangalore. 2 years, it has been 2 or 3 years now, right? So I'm very thankful for that company, because whenever I visit Bangalore, the only thing I do is I use Bounce. I don't use Ola Uber. I only use Bounce over there. I will, like, you can rent a scooty which is parked somewhere. You can go put the pin, rent it, reach the destination and park it there and leave it. So lock it down.
Drivability point.
Yeah. So that is why, because of the whole traffic situation, I prefer Bounce, using Bounce over there. Right. So anyways, so give me two more slides. And then I think I will, like, during that explanation, I think most of your questions will be solved. But yes, after that, I can resume with these questions. So just give me 2 more slides. So this is about BLDC induction and PMSM motor, right? So this is on the basis of the operating construction, right? But if I say now in case of electric vehicle, apart from that, like the, so apart from that, we also have, so some of you might have heard about the hub motor, and some of you might have heard about in-wheel motor, and some of you might have heard about both hub motor and in-wheel motors, right? So this is also kind of motor that we have a choice for, right? So in case of two-wheelers specifically, you can see that we have hub motors in the case of two-wheelers, right? So especially the low speed two-wheelers, like up to 2 kilowatt, you can see hub motor being used in the two-wheelers, right? So hub motors are basically over here in this image. You can see hub motors are basically, you take the rim of the rim of the wheel, right, and you integrate a motor inside it, right? So you Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, sorry for that. Hub motor, you might have seen in most of the two-wheelers, we have hub motor. So what is hub motor? Hub motor is basically, we are redesigning the rim of the wheel. Okay, we are redesigning the rim of the wheel so that we can place a motor inside the rim itself or the wheel itself, right? So in case of hub motor, we are placing the motor inside the hub. And the hub or the rim of the wheel will act as the casing, right, of the motor, right? So the motor is integrated, as you can see in this image also, right? So the hub part or the central part will be the stator, and the outer part will be the rotor so that the wheel can rotate, right? So this is how the hub motor is, right? And the second option that this you will be able to see mostly in case of two-wheelers, right? Now, the second option that you have is of in-wheel motor, right? So the in case of in-wheel motor, as you can see from this image also, so this in case of in-wheel motor, you can see there is a motor, like a separate motor will be there, which will be attached directly to the wheel. Okay. So usually I have seen many people getting confused between hub motor and in-wheel motor, the terminologies. So this is the basic difference between the hub motor and the in-wheel motor. In case of hub motor, the motor is a part of the rim or the wheel. And in case of in-wheel motor, the motor is attached directly to the wheel. Okay. So this is the major difference between these two, right? And these two are the configurations that you have. So hub motor, now coming to hub motor or in-wheel motor. Now in this case, the major advantage that you get in this case is that because motor is attached directly to the wheel, right? So you can get more, you can get much better efficiency. Basically, you are reducing whatever the transmission loss that might occur, you are reducing that also, right? You are reducing that transmission loss, right? And thus you can get a much better efficiency, right? In case of in-wheel motor. Okay. And when it comes to or in-wheel motor or hub motor. So that is the major advantage that you have, right? And as well as these motors are the one which are generating more torque, right? These motors will be generating more torque and less RPM as compared to their other counterpart, which is the chassis mounted motor, we say, right? So the normal fixed motor or the chassis mounted motor, so those motors are rotating, are smaller in size as compared to these motors, right? And they deliver high RPM and low torque. Okay, so they will be ranging from up to 3000 RPM, 4000 RPM, something like that, right? So they can go up to somewhat high RPM, but the torque value will be not as much high. You would have to use gear ratios or gear reduction in order to obtain the torque that you want, right? But over here, in case of hub motor, you would have, because the motor is attached directly to the wheel, so in that hub motor or in-wheel motor, so due to that, the torque output of these motors are very high and the RPM is low, right? And due to that, and because it is attached directly to the wheel, the efficiency is higher because you are reducing whatever the transmission loss that might be there. But the drawback, the major drawback of this configuration is of unsprung mass, right? Unsprung mass or the weight of the wheel is increased now, right? So when you go into, like, if you are riding and suddenly a ditch comes, right? So the wheel will be falling down or rising up at much higher, with much higher velocity, with much higher force actually, right? So wheel will be exerting more force on the suspension itself, right? So the suspension suspension needs to be designed in a much, like, the spring damper combination that you are using or the shock absorber that you are using needs to be strong enough to compensate for this force that is incoming, right? Because apart from the force coming from the road, you also have the weight of the wheel that to counter, right? So that will be a challenge on the suspension side. Now, apart from this, now, because the weight of the wheel has increased, so the impact force on the rim has also increased, right? So impact force on the rim will also increase due to the weight under free motion, right? When it comes to ditch or bump, right? So in that case, again, there are chances that the rim might damage easily, right? Right. So there are chances that the rim might damage easily. And if the rim damages, now this is where the difference between in-wheel and hub motor comes. Okay. If the rim damages, so in case of hub motor, you would have to replace the whole motor itself. Right. But in case of in-wheel motor, you just have to replace the rim. Right. So that is why in case of four-wheelers, we preferably go for in-wheel motor, not the hub motor. In case of two-wheeler, we are stuck with hub motor because we don't have so much space to introduce an in-wheel motor concept, right? We don't have that much space over there or the wheel design in that way. But in case of four-wheelers, the design of the wheel is in such a way that we can introduce in-wheel motor concept so that when, if on a high impact, the rim will damage, the motor will remain safe, and we can always change the rim at cost lower than as compared to changing the whole motor. Right. So that is why, and that is also one of the reasons why you will see that the two wheelers, which are having higher speeds of more than 45 kmph, right? Right now, all the products that are available in the market, the two wheelers having speed higher than 45 kmph will not be using hub motor. They are not using hub motors. They are using fixed motor, because if you are increasing the speed, so is the chances of impact forces, right? Like if you are going at higher speeds, so the impact forces will also increase and more chances will be of damaging the rim in one way or the other. And then again, the customer would have to replace the whole rim along with the motor, right? Which will be costly, right? So in order to keep that in control, what we do, we use fixed motor over there, okay? Or the chassis mounted motor, right? We don't use hub motor over there. But at lower speeds, lower than 45 kmph, especially for 500 watt, 1000 watt applications, we use hub motor because those vehicles are not going about 25-30 kmph. Okay. And apart from that, again due to the issue of cooling, like it is difficult to cool because these motors are generating very high torque, so they will be generating more heat as compared to the fixed motors, right? So these motors will be generating more heat as compared to the fixed motor because they are generating high torque, right? So and if you basically if you are increasing the torque, right, so if you are increasing the torque of the motor, so you would have to increase voltage and current. That is what you have to do, right? And if you are increasing the voltage and current, obviously you are increasing the heat, right, which is I square R, right? So obviously you will be increasing the heat generated and thus the cooling becomes difficult. So that is why hub motors in two wheelers also, you won't see hub motors beyond 1 or 1.5 kilowatt application. Beyond that, you won't see hub motors easily, right? Because after that, because the heat management is not there, proper heat management is not there. So these motors will start generating more losses. Okay. Right. And in case of in wheel motor, again, that is the advantage is that just like we are applying, hydraulics to the brake shoe, right? Because the stator is the one which needs to be cooled down, right? So just like we are applying hydraulics to the brake shoe, we can apply hydraulics to the stator in order to cool it down, right? In case of in wheel motor. But that again becomes quite difficult in case of hub motor because the stator is inside the rim. Like you don't have any direct access to the stator. Okay. You don't have direct access to such kind of direct access to the stator so that you can apply cooling system to it. Okay. But in case of in wheel motor, you can see we have stator over here. So we can always apply a cooling system from the back side of the stator or through the like through the power electronic side, like on this side from the back side of the stator, you can apply circulatory like liquid cooling system, like you can apply that. But over here, because stator is inside and the housing is rotating, like it is you don't have direct access to the stator from the outside. You would have to open the motor in order to get the access to the stator. So that is why hub motors, you will see beyond it is usually 1 to 1.2 kilowatt or 1.5 kilowatt. Beyond that, it is not recommended to use hub motors, right? And so that is the major differences over here, or advantage or disadvantage of using hub motor or in wheel motors. In wheel motors are, so hub motors are basic, majorly BLDC motors. But as Venkat mentioned yesterday, there are some companies which are coming up with the induction motor also in hub format. And then you have in wheel motors. So in wheel motors are mostly permanent magnet synchronous motors or BLDC motors, right? So that is what in wheel motors are. Then we had BLDC induction PMSM motor, then we have hub motor and in wheel motor. Now after that, there is another motor which I think some of you might have heard of, which is axial flux motor, right? Now this is new into the market. Okay, this motor is new into the market. Now in this motor, you can see over here we have stator in the middle and we have rotor on the sides, right? Now the major USP of this motor is that it has a very good flux density, right? Or flux density basically. So rotor will consist of magnet, as you can see in the image, right? And the stator will consist of winding. So and because they are consist of magnets, the magnetic field line will go in this way. Let me try and draw if I can. So the magnetic field lines will be this way, right? From that end to this end, like this, which is parallel to axis. That is why these are axial flux motors. Okay. Right. Although the control methods will be same as that of you take a BLDC motor or an induction motor or a PMSM motor and change the position of the magnet and stator in this way, and that is axial flux. So this is this type of motor is on the, this is on the basis of the construction of the motor. Traditionally we had radial flux motor where the flux was parallel to the radius. In this, we are providing flux in parallel to the axis. Okay, so this is axial flux motor. I will just show you a small video of this motor. So there is a company called Magnax, which showed a very, like, for the first time, they showed about 3 years ago, they were the ones which came up with this motor, and they showed the successful prototype of it. So I'll just show you the video. So this is what the difference you have between the radial flux motor and the axial flux motor. Okay. So this is just a comparison that they have shown of the difference, the size. So you can see the axial flux motor, because of the high flux density, it is really compact. It is really compact for the same amount of power delivered. Okay. It could be really compact. So I'll just pause it here for 5 to 10 seconds. If you want, you can note these points, right? So they have patented system for cooling the winding. So basically this whole motor is patent of Magnax now, right now. Although there are companies, apart from Magnax, there are several other companies working on the axial flux motors, but this cooling system for this magnet and this configuration right now is patent of Magnax. Then they have rectangular copper wire for highest possible copper fill factor, which is 90%. Okay. Then they have concentrated winding, dual permanent magnet rotor. So as you can see, there are two rotors, and rotors are consisting of magnet. So yes, then you have yokeless stator for shortest possible flux path, right? So which you can see, because it is a direct path, right? And grain oriented electrical steel to reduce copper losses, or core losses, basically, not copper losses, core losses or iron losses. So in case of electric cars, this is how you can use these motors, right? So you can, like, you can see the scale by which you are able to reduce, and not only for a fixed motor. So over here, the application that they have shown is in the form of fixed motor. But right now, AVL is the company, which is one of the major powertrain giants, right, in the world. So AVL is trying to use axial flux motor as in-wheel motor, like as a replacement for in-wheel motor, right? So they are trying to use this motor in that way. Right. So this was about the axial flux motor. So this was about an axial flux motor. And in India also, there is a company name. I will just write the company's name in the chat box. So there is a company named Quantian Powertrain. Right. So it is in the incubation. It is in the incubation center of IIT Delhi, right? So they are working with the incubation of IIT Delhi, and they are trying to develop the axial flux motor. And the owner of that company is actually, that company is owned by one of the owners. I know him, which is Ramesh Lakra. Ramesh Lakra is the name for the guy, right? So you can search him on the LinkedIn. He is there. So he has had an experience of working in submarines and all. So after that, he was in Navy, he worked at submarines and all. And after that, after retiring, he has started this company, Quantin Powertrain, about two years back, right? So they have developed their first prototype. Right now they are in the process of patenting their prototypes and validation, prototype validation and patenting. In that process they are right now. So that is there. Okay. So now with this, now you can give me the question. Like, I believe for both, I think some of your questions or doubts might be cleared now. So yeah, now if you have any questions, yes, in this part.
Participants, if you have any doubts, you unmute yourself and get clarified.
Sir?
Yes, sir.
Sir, there are also hub motors available. Of course, people say it has some disadvantages.
Mm-hmm.
Can you throw some light on that, sir? And also, are there any Indian manufacturers?
Actually, for motors, currently there are very limited manufacturers are there. Like very localized manufacturing is being done. Okay, for motors, most of these people are getting, right now most of the companies are getting motors directly imported from China or Germany or Switzerland, from somewhere like that. Right. Now, if you talk about the limitations of hub motors, so in case of limitations, so as I've already mentioned, the major limitation of hub motor is that the mass of the wheel increases, right? And due to that, at higher speeds, because the wheel mass is increased, so the impact force on the wheel will also increase, right? Because like example, there is a speed breaker, right? Now you have jumped the speed breaker, right? You have crossed the speed breaker, and after there is a certain very small short distance where the wheel is in the air, and after which it will touch the ground, right? Now, because the wheel mass is increased, and earlier what used to happen is, because most of the mass is in with the chassis, and it is suspension is observing most of the forces going to the wheel. So what will happen? The suspension will absorb most of the forces, right? So wheel will not have that much of impact force. But if the motor is in the wheel itself, that will increase the weight of the wheel, right? And as a result, when it hits the ground, so there are chances that if there is some sharp object or if there is some stone or something like that, so there are chances that you might damage the rim itself, especially given the cases of our India where the roads are not that good. So in that case, there are chances that you might damage the rim itself, right? And if you damage the rim, then in that case, you would have to replace the rim, which means in case of hub motors that you will have to replace the whole motor itself, right? So that will be costly. That is the major drawback of using hub motor. The second major drawback is the cooling. So for the design of the hub motor is in such a way that the stator is not directly accessible. So, and because they are generating high torque, and as a result, they are generating very high heat also. Heat generation is also higher. And because the stator is not accessible, so you are not able to provide a proper cooling method to that motor. So these two are the major disadvantages for hub motor.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Sir, I will try to connect online for other queries, because we are involved in a project wherein we are designing suspension system, cooling system for battery pack, etc. Okay. So we are very new to these niche areas.
Okay, so you are from some institution or?
Yes, sir. I am from Chandra Kumar from RV College of Engineering.
Oh, Chandra Kumar, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We talked yesterday also. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So I'll connect offline, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Sure. Which motor is best for heavy load purpose for EV? Vivek, it depends. So if you are talking about a light commercial vehicle, which is basically Tata Ape or Chota Hathi, that we say Tata Ape or Mahindra. Mahindra has... I'm forgetting the name of that vehicle, right? Basically, like the similar kind of vehicles, right? For those vehicles, currently we are using up to 15 kilowatt BLDC motor. Okay, for those vehicles we are using 15 kilowatt BLDC motor. Okay, 10 kilowatt, 15 kilowatt, that is like depending upon the manufacturer to manufacturer. So it varies between 10 kilowatt to 15 kilowatt, but they are using BLDC motor, right? But usually the generally the law says that if you are moving more than 15 kilowatt, so usually we switch to AC motor rather than BLDC motor for power requirements more than 15 kilowatt because of the efficiency range. BLDC motor has an efficiency range of 35% to 95%, right? So on the one hand, it gives 95%, the other hand, it will give 35% also. Right? So that is why we move to AC motor, which is induction or PMSM motor. Now, when it comes to load purposes, like if you're talking about trucks, so in that case, we are using induction motor because the load variation is too much. And they are always going in on various off-road situations and all everything. So induction motor can easily handle all those load variations, right? If you are talking about bus, so in that case, we prefer PMSM motor because the load variation is there, but the driving condition or the drive cycle, you might say, for the buses are not as rough as that of truck, right? Or the driving conditions are not as rough as that of trucks, right? So that is why we will be using PMSM motors in that case. Right. And there are some manufacturers who are using induction motor also. So in case of buses, for premium buses, PMSM is good. But if you want to keep the cost low, then again, you will have to go for induction motor. So that is again, your personal choice, what you want to do. Right. Participant, if you have, okay, sorry. So yeah, any other questions?
Sir, good morning, sir. This is Vivek. My question is that, sir, what is the scope of electric vehicle in those areas, like in our country, hilly areas are there. Basically, I belong to Uttarakhand. Yeah. I'm basically from Dehradun. Mm-hmm. I have seen electric buses are running in my city, only in Dehradun itself. And electric buses are not available in hilly areas. So what is the scope for electric vehicle in hilly areas, sir?
For hilly areas. So actually, in hilly areas, yes, the electric vehicles right now, it is quite difficult because again, for hilly areas, see the major requirement, there are two terms we have power and torque, right? So the power for the electric vehicle, so power will give you acceleration, right? And torque will give you load carrying capacity. Okay. So the hilly areas that we are talking about, right? So in order to be able to climb in hilly areas, you need more torque, right? But if you are having more torque, that means you will be having less speed comparatively, right? And as a result, now if you talk in terms of battery, so battery will provide you range. And if your speed is less, so the range will not be that much higher, right? So that is the major challenge that you have in case of hilly areas right now. So unless we are able to improvise because motors are already efficient, you can see they are 98%, 95% efficient. Right, there is very less room in that sector. So right now we are more dependent upon the battery in that part, to be honest. Right. So I think this answers.
Sir, we have to be I think we have to be change the power drive also for that. If batteries are efficient, then we have to be look in the design of power drive.
Yeah.
That means like, the gate range and all these things.
Yeah. I'll be coming to that part also. Yeah. So we have to look into that. Thank I'll you. Be coming to that part also, the gearbox. Axial flux motor is
right. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So axial flux is new into market. Up to when it will gain popularity? Okay. Before I answer this question, I would like to know what was the time limitation for this session? I'm slightly confused. Robin, sir?
Sir, you have up to 12 o'clock up to, sir.
Okay, and the next one will be, next is also my session, right? So that will be from?
Sorry, this session up to 12 o'clock, then 12:15 to 1:45,
okay.
Sir.
12:15 to 1:45. Okay, fine. Okay, thank you. So, okay. Right. So now to answer your question, as axial flux motor is new in market, so up to when it will gain popularity? Right now, Pramod, the major challenge with axial flux motor is the low cost manufacturing of the stator core. Okay, so as you can see over here in the stator side, so the design of the stator is slightly different from the what we used to have in case of radial flux. But in case of radial flux, if I take you slightly back in the previous slide, so in case of radial flux, if you see, right, so right, in case of radial flux, if you just imagine this, you have square plate, the size of this image, and you can punch out the stator by just like, you can just punch and you can take out one lamina of the stator, right? So the manufacturing over there is very cheap because it is really easy. Like, okay, so in this way, you can mass manufacture it easily. You can just, you have to just punch the laminas out, stack them together, and the stator is formed, right? But in this case, which is of axial flux motor, now in this case, if I take you, so over here, you can see the shape. Shape is quite different, and this shape is quite difficult to mass produce right now. So that is why, like, that is, so it, to come into the market, right? So axial flux motors are there into the market, but they are right, currently they are on the prototype stage because of the production cost as well as of the performance. Like, the performance is there, but still people are trying to figure out more efficient ways in order to utilize these motors. So I think, as far as I've talked to Ramesh sir also and everyone, like what they have told me is that it will take up to 5 years, 4 to 5 years, like minimum it will take for axial flux to be there into the market. Although on the cost factor, they haven't given it. Like, also, I also asked them also about this, but they haven't given me any ballpark figure to say as such. Right. So once I will know, I will definitely share with you all. But yeah, so I think this should like answer your question, query. Okay. So right now, going forward with so in meanwhile, if you have any other query, you can just post it. Meanwhile, I will cover the forward sections. Right. So this was about the types of motors which are being used, right? Now, this is up to this point, we were taking a look at different types of motors, right? Yesterday, we saw my colleague Aman told you about how to calculate the power and torque for the motor, right? But there is another limitation that comes into the play, which is torque limitation, right? It's not only about calculating the torque. Right. It's not only about calculating the power and the torque. It's also about, will this torque be enough for the vehicle? Enough in the sense, not that obviously you are calculating, so that torque will be required. Obviously, the motor that you will be selecting should be of having torque or power value greater than what you have calculated, right? Equal or greater than or equal to what you have calculated. Right? But in that also, what is the limitation? Right. There is a certain limitation that comes into the play, right? To understand that, we have to take a look at this graph, right? But before taking a look at this graph, we have to understand two parameters. The very first parameter is slip ratio. So I think almost all of us know that. So basically, for a wheel, when you are applying a traction force, right? So, just take a pen. Okay. Take a pen, you all might be having a pen, and just push it on the table, like keep it on the table and give it a slight push. So the pen will start rotating and moving forward, right? That is what we call as roll, right? But if you place your finger on the pen and try to force the finger, try to give a high force, like, right? If you try to force the pen through the finger, so immediately the pen will jump and it will move forward at very high speed. Like, it will, the distance covered will not be that much. It will cover very short distance, but the rotational speed will be very high, right? So that is slip. So in case of wheel also, similarly, when the traction force is greater than mu w, in that case, we experience slip, which is a normal scenario, right? But we have this parameter of slip ratio in order to determine how much amount of slip is the wheel experiencing in order to understand if you are under the spin region. Because if your vehicle is not moving forward, but the wheel is rotating, that means your wheel is spinning. We don't want that, right? We don't want that situation to occur. Well, you might have seen in movies, especially when they are like, revving the engine, and suddenly if they release the clutch, immediately the wheel will start spinning first, right? The vehicle will not move immediately. The wheels will spin first and then the vehicle will move. And like, especially the children will see that thing and they will find that, okay, it is very cool. But when it comes to vehicle dynamics, that is not what we want. Okay, we don't want that. That is really bad for the wheel as well as for the vehicle, right? And as well as for the race purposes, right? So if you are going to race, and if especially if you are racing, and when your wheel does that, you don't want that, right? So we have this quantity slip ratio in order to determine how much slip is there and at what point, and we have this graph to understand at what point should we, like, will that wheel be 10, wheel will transform to spinning condition, right? So the slip ratio in, although it has a different formula also, but for a simple understanding, you can take slip ratio as wheel velocity divided by vehicle velocity minus one. Okay, this is like for the simple formula for a slip ratio. Okay, wheel velocity means omega r, the rotational velocity of the wheel, omega, into radius, omega r, divided by vehicle's actual velocity, right, minus one. That is slip ratio. Okay, right, so that will be slip ratio. And then the other parameter that we have is normalized traction force. So normalized traction force is basically, in order to understand the difference, how, if you are increasing, basically if you are increasing the traction force, because slip will occur when the force is greater than mu w, right? So when we are increasing the traction force, how the slip ratio is differing, how there is the difference in slip ratios there, how it is changing. So in order to understand that, instead of force, we are taking normalized traction force value over here so that we can get a better figure, because the load on the wheel will differ, right? Or load on the vehicle, for different vehicle, the load will be different. So to get a generic graph or a generic idea, right? So we use this parameter, normalized traction force, which is traction force upon normal force, right? So that is what we have. Now, so is this clear, like slip ratio and normal traction force? Because before going to the graph, I want to know, like, if you are clear on these two terms.
Sir, which, yes, means slip ratio should be zero, right?
Yes, ideally it should be zero, yes. And while acceleration, while accelerating, the slip ratio value will be in positive, and while braking, it will be in negative.
Okay, sir.
Any other questions? Like, so I believe we are clear on these two terms, right? Slip ratio and normalized traction force. Okay. So now if we come to take a look at this graph, so on the y-axis, we have normalized traction force, and on the x-axis, we have slip ratio, right? So if you see, the graph is increasing up to a point where the ratio is one. That means the traction force is equal to the normal or the weight acting on the wheel. So because, see, vehicle has four wheels, right? And on each wheel, a certain portion of the total weight of the vehicle will be acting on each wheel, right? Or you can say, if you take a uni wheel model, a unicycle model, we say, right? Or quarter car model is also another name for that, quarter car model. So in quarter car model, what we do, we take, like, if you take the whole weight of the wheel, weight of the vehicle, and there is a single wheel to hold that weight, so the traction force will keep on increasing. And when the traction force is equal to the weight acting on the wheel, so that means the ratio is one. So initially, when you are increasing the traction force, so up to the ratio one, or when the traction force is equal to the weight, the slip ratio will also increase. But in that case, so this region, this first region from zero to the point where you have this maximized normalized force, right? So up to that, this region is the operating region. Okay, this is the region in which you want your wheel to operate. Okay, now what happens after that? After that, you are increasing the force. Like if you keep increasing the force after that also, that means the traction force is greater than the normal force or the weight. So traction force is greater than mg. So in that case, what will happen? Although you are increasing the traction force, but the resultant force on the wheel or the resultant or the effective traction force on the wheel will start reducing, right? It will start reducing because now the wheel is experiencing slip at a higher ratio. A higher ratio in the sense that the wheel will start losing the traction, right? Because of the high tension that is being created. Okay, because of the high tension that is being created, right? And as a result, now when the traction force is double, when this ratio is one, or you can say when the wheel velocity is double that of vehicle velocity. So in that case, you find the wheel spinning condition according to SAE definition, right? So you reach the wheel spinning condition, right? So from this graph, what we can obtain from this graph is that, yes, the motor torque we calculated, right? Now, while placing the motor, we should keep that in mind that the torque being delivered to the wheel should not exceed the normal weight acting on the wheel. So that is also one of the limitations that you have and that you need to look for. Okay. So basically that is what I wanted to say. So usually I have seen that. So that is why if you see for high performance vehicles now, right? So high performance vehicles, in case of IC engine, they will be using traction control system. So traction control system will control the torque on the wheel, right? Initially. So in order to prevent spin, Formula One also uses that. Like Formula One used to use that 2 years back, they changed the regulation. They said that for starting of the race will not be controlled by electronics anymore. So the driver has to manually control the torque to the wheel, right? But yes, the Formula One cars still have that traction control. High-end cars, you will see, they have all the high-end cars, they will have traction control, right? In order to prevent the wheel spin, because we do not want that, right? And in case of when it comes to electric vehicle, you will see that the high-end vehicles, like for those using more than 200 kilowatt of motor, so as soon as they go more than that, so immediately they will start using two different motors, one in the front, one in the, like they will switch to all-wheel drive. Okay, they will try to switch to all-wheel drive because that will be the case, right? And similarly, when it comes to buses and trucks, so that is why in case of buses and trucks, you can see the traction force is provided, although the engine is in the front, but the transmission is provided to the rear wheel because the load is on the rear wheel. And that is why you want the traction force to be applied on the rear wheel in order to be able to move the vehicle. Instead of adding load, like adding transmission to the front wheel, we provide it to the rear wheel so that we can move the vehicle easily, right? In all the commercial vehicles, you can see, right? So that is there. Okay. Is this clear?
Sir, you talked about the traction control system. Actually, yeah. Okay, it has electronics. So how does it actually reduce the torque, sir? Or how does it actually reduce the traction?
Okay, but in case of traction control system, okay, just give me a second. Give me a second. I'll show you a graph. Okay. This is from one of the sessions that we take. So usually in one of our courses of EV design and development, so I take this topic. So over here, you can see. So for every engine, we have what we call as fuel map, right? So this is for 3000 GT Spider 1995 model, right? So this is a fuel map for this engine, right? So you can see we have different fuel ratios being written over here, right? Now, let's say ideally or in the normal operational condition, so this is the path that your engine will follow. Okay. This is the path that your engine will follow, which is red line. Okay. Now suddenly if you are, let's say you are at 2000 RPM, right? And suddenly you you press the throttle hard and you want more torque. Okay, you want more torque. So in order to provide more torque, you need more fuel, right? So immediately the graph will shift from to this. So from 2000 RPM, immediately the graph will shift in this way, right? So ECU will do the calculation on the basis of the feedback loop coming from the torque, from the engine, the RPM, wheel, and everything. So on basis of the feedback loop, the ECU will control how much fuel is being injected into the engine. So that is what the major advantage you have in case of MPFI, fuel injections, right? So fuel, every fuel injection vehicle will be following a certain map for its engine, right? And accordingly, the ECU will be calculating which value to obtain and how much fuel to be injected and how much valve to be open. I think this should make it clear for you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right. Any other question?
Sir, shall we conclude?
Sir, actually, I have few more slides left. Although, sir,
sir, proceed, sir.
Yeah. And the next session is also mine, sir. Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So yeah, okay. So this is about the torque limitation factor, right? Now coming to the next part, which is gearbox selection, which one of you also asked about, like, do we need to work on the transmission part? I think Vivek asked that, right? So regarding that, so why I am including this topic also, because in case of electric vehicle, in case of electric vehicle community or the industry, there is a very, very, very common debate is there always. Like even whenever you throw this topic, there will be a debate happening, right? Which is immediately everyone will go into debate mode, which is, do we need a multi-speed gearbox in electric vehicle or not? Okay. So traditionally we are using a single speed gearbox, right? We are using a single speed gearbox. And in case of two wheeler, we are using belt drive. Right, traditionally, in case of electric vehicle. And because obviously the motors are very, like, the operational methods of the motor make them very flexible as per the requirement, right? They can, their operational conditions might are very flexible in nature, right? So that gives us the advantage of using gearbox as per our will, right? Basically a single speed gearbox is enough for them usually, because you can vary the large amount of torque and RPM as per the, by varying the motors, right? But to be honest, that is not the only part where the gearbox plays the role. And that is where, like, most of the industry persons know that, but when it comes to electric vehicles, see, the major issue with electric vehicle is that the whole electric vehicle industry has been founded by, or has been established by people. See, this might hurt some of the people's sentiment, but to be told, it has been established by people who are proud of the electric motors, which is nothing wrong. But the problem is that in that context, I have found, like, in my debates also, like with most of the people, I have found that they lose that general idea of the gearbox. See, the primary motive behind gearbox is not only to regulate the torque and speed of the engine, right? Which we will see just now. Okay. So the gearbox selection, like, should we use multi-speed gearbox or not, right? We should use a single speed gearbox, that is for sure, like, which is being used, right? But shall we use multi-speed gearbox or not? Because most of the people will say to you that gearbox will bring losses, which is true. Gearbox will bring losses. But then why are these cars like Porsche Taycan, then in Formula E, and then there are several other market products which are using multi-speed, two or three speed gearboxes, right? So why are they using multi-speed gearbox if it is bringing losses? So do they want to induce losses in their system knowingly, right? So to understand that, let's take a look at the engine's characteristic first, right? So in case of engine, we know that engine has a point of maximum torque and maximum power, right? So this is the power torque characteristic of the engine with respect to speed, right? So you can see the torque will increase. You can see the torque will increase. It will reach a maximum value, which is intersected by the orange line over here, right? And then it will remain there for some time, and then it will start decreasing. This is how the torque of the engine will go, right? While meanwhile, the power will keep on increasing till it reaches the peak value, which is the intersection of the blue line, and then it will decrease, right? This is how the power will go, right? Now, the region in between these two points, which is of maximum torque and the maximum power. So this is ideally the operating region of the engine. Okay, this is the operational region where we want, or this is the region where we want our engine to operate ideally, right? Why? Because maximum torque and maximum power is the region where you'll give a you'll get maximum efficiency also, right? So this is the region where you will get maximum efficiency also. How? So if you take a look at this graph over here at below, which is specific fuel consumption, right? Now, specific fuel consumption is basically, if you can see over here, the formula is given. Specific fuel consumption is fuel intake for power generated, right? So for each kilowatt or each watt generated at that particular RPM, how much fuel your engine is consuming, that is specific fuel consumption, right? So lower value of specific fuel consumption means higher efficiency, which again is evident from the formula below. Efficiency is given by 1 divided by specific fuel consumption into energy density of the fuel, right? So if you have lower specific fuel consumption, that means you will have higher efficiency, right? So if you come to the graph, so this green point, the green line where this green line is intersecting at that RPM, you will have your maximum efficiency, which in every engine generally comes immediately after maximum torque. Like at immediately few RPMs after maximum torque, you will find maximum efficiency also, right? So, but in case of engine, this is the operating region that you have. You want your engine to operate between maximum torque and maximum power. Okay, this red and blue line, you want your engine to operate between these two lines, okay? So I think this should be pretty much clear to you all, right? So then it is like pretty simple. Okay. But now when we come to the gearbox, so now with this same plot on the right hand side, I have a plot for gearbox. Okay. So where we have first gear, second gear, third gear, fourth gear. Okay. Now let's say I am running at 60 at the speed of 60 miles per hour, which is 100 kmph. Okay. So let's say I am running at this speed of 100 kmph or 60 miles per hour, right? So at this speed, now as per the graph, you can see I can run at 60 miles per hour on second gear, third gear, and fourth gear. On all these three gears, I can run at 60 miles per hour, right? So now the question is, on which gear should I run? Like which gear, on which gear would it be better to run at 60 miles per hour? On which gear it would be better?
Fourth, sir.
Fourth. Why fourth? Fourth gear, like most of us have this understanding that the fourth gear will be better, but why?
As the attractive force is more, does it consume lesser specific fuel consumption?
Okay. See, okay. So let me, okay, I won't be able, okay, just give me a second. I think I might be able to type it over here. Just give me a second, right? So if I, let's say for second, if I'm running this on second gear, so let's say the RPM is around 5,500, Okay. If I'm running on third gear, so let's say the RPM is around 3,800, right? And if I'm running on fourth gear, the RPM is around 2,600. Okay. So let's keep it that way. Yes. Right. Okay. Okay. It has come here also, right? So these are the RPM. So for, let's say for second gear, it is at 5,500 RPM. Third gear, it is at 3,800 RPM. Fourth gear, it is at 2,600 RPM. So now in this case, which gear would be better for 60 miles per hour? If I want to travel at 60 miles per hour, so which gear would be better? No. Okay. So let's take a look at how these in each gear, what will be the state of the engine, right? So in second gear, we are at 5,500 RPM, right? So 5,500 RPM would be somewhere in this region, which is beyond peak power. And the specific, if you see, the specific fuel consumption is high. That means efficiency is low, right? And apart from this, you also have to take a look at another graph, which is absolute fuel consumption, which I'll just draw roughly the graph goes like this. Okay, absolute fuel consumption. So apart from specific fuel consumption, we also need to consider absolute fuel consumption, right? Specific fuel consumption is fuel consumption for power generated. Absolute fuel consumption is how much fuel you are giving per second, right? So now if you see, specific fuel consumption is high, the power is decreasing, right? And as well as the absolute fuel consumption is also high. So obviously I won't run at I won't use second gear, right? That is obvious. Now when I am on third gear, right? When I am on third gear, so at 3,800 RPM, so almost near the green region, almost near the green line, right? So specific fuel consumption is low, right? For third gear, the specific fuel consumption is low, as well as at the same time, the absolute fuel consumption is also low, right? Basically, right now, when in third gear, I'm in the operating region, which is between maximum torque and maximum power, right? And then I have fourth gear, right? So in case of fourth gear, my specific fuel consumption is somewhat higher than what it would have been in third gear, but the absolute fuel consumption is low, right? So what it means, if you want to overtake someone, right? If you want to overtake someone, if you want to accelerate, so 60 miles per hour, you will be traveling at 60 miles per hour in third gear. You will go to third gear, right? But when you are on highway, right? When you are on highway, you have open road in front of you. So in that case, 60 miles per hour in fourth gear will give you better range. In third gear, it will give you better efficiency, and thus you will be able to overtake the person in front of you easily, right? But in fourth gear, it will give you better range because the absolute fuel consumption is low. Are you able to get this difference? Hello.
Sir,
this is a general question to everyone. Like, are you able to understand this difference of driving in third gear and fourth gear for the same speed? Like in third gear.
Sure.
Yeah. Right. Yes. Mm-hmm. So in third gear, you have maximum efficiency, but the fuel consumption is high as compared to fourth gear. So for the same distance travel, you are consuming more fuel, right? But the efficiency is high. So you can overtake in that gear. Like if you want to overtake someone, if you want to accelerate. So that is why when we want to accelerate harder, we go one gear down, right? We'll shift down the gear, right? But if you are cruising at 60 miles per hour, and so in that case, the fourth gear will be better because the fuel consumption is low, right? And for the same distance travel, you are consuming less fuel. So the range is usually given in kilometer per liter, right? So which is distance travel divided by fuel consumed. So obviously in case of fourth gear, you will get more kilometers per liter, but in third gear, you will get more kilowatt per liter, right? So similarly, now similar principle applies to the motor also, right? So that is why Porsche Taycan and all, they are using multi-speed gearbox, because what they are using is they are using the first gear to gain more torque, right? And then after that, they want to they have attained a certain speed, then after that, they will switch to second gear so that the motor will come back to its low energy consumption mode, and that distance travel will be more, like for less energy consumed. The car will be able to travel more distance, right? So the Porsche Taycan uses three different gear ratios for that. So it has a three gear gearbox, okay, three speed gearbox. Then Formula E uses two speed gearbox. So one is for acceleration, torque, for high torque, and the other one is for range, right? To be able to complete the race, especially 2 years back when the FIA has announced that they have to complete the whole race in single battery pack. So after that, most of them has opted for a multi-speed gearbox, two-speed gearbox, right? So that is, and now in that context, there were some students from Switzerland. So they did this research, sorry, not Switzerland, Netherlands, TUV University, right? So they did this research and they found out that if you are using two gears, you can increase the range by 5 to 6%, 3 gears, 10 to 11%, and 4 gears, you will be able to increase the range by 23 to 25% in case of electric vehicle, right? But now the question is, why manufacturers are not doing so? Because the battery pack is heavy enough, so they don't want to increase the weight even further. Apart from that, they don't want to increase the cost of the vehicle even further, right? So these are the two major reasons why most of the manufacturers are not on the normal passenger car level. They are not opting for this option, right? So that is there. And apart from this, there's just one last slide where I just wanted to show you the whole architecture, a small overview of the whole architecture. So we have electric motor in the center. On the left side, we have electric input. On the right side, we have mechanical output. So mechanical output side, we have gearbox, differential, everything is there. Electrical input side, we have throttle. So throttle will take the signal provided to the controller, right? Controller will calculate how much voltage and how much energy is required to be fed to the motor. And it will ask the BMS for that energy. And BMS will borrow the energy from the battery pack. Now, while this whole process is going on, we have a VCU also in case of electric vehicles. We have a VCU also, which will be acting as a supervisor to the whole system. So VCU will be communicating with all of these components, BMS, throttle, controller, motor, all of these components individually in order to ensure the communication flow is maintained, right? And if there is any error, it will immediately show it on your dashboard, right? So this is how the whole integration is for the whole system, right? So with this, my presentation is done for this session. If you have any questions. Yeah. Any questions you want to ask or anything you want to know in this whole?
Sir, very nice presentation. I have a question, sir. Ronak, sir, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, yes, sir. I just very general question. I want to know that when will India fully convert their conventional vehicle to electric vehicle? Do you have any idea? Or maybe it will increase the traffic on the road if electrical vehicle will incorporate in the road on the our country? Sir, any idea?
Actually, so this traffic part, I remember one more point that one of that madam had mentioned about the velocity, right? So the velocity of the electric vehicle is more dependent upon the power. So right now, the most of the two wheelers that we have, for example, if you take Ather is 1,20,000, 1,30,000 is the cost, but it can go up to 75, 80, 90. They have claimed, right? They can go up to 90. RV 400 can go up to 90. Again, it is 1,30,000. So because it has a powerful motor, right? So that is one of the things. So in that context, I want to say that the electric vehicles are not slow. Okay. Like they can be fast, but right now under the condition, fast electric vehicle will mean more cost. Right. Now, till when the electric vehicle will be possible in India? So like electric vehicle is there. Government is trying to push as much as they want. Like recently in Delhi government has recently declared that any commercial vehicle, in the sense that the cabs or taxis, which are, I think, 10 year old cab and taxis, their registrations had been, or 10 year or more than that. So their registrations have been canceled. Okay. So they cannot operate anymore in Delhi. Right. So they have recently done this, especially for diesel segment. Right. So in order to reduce pollution and in order to promote more towards the electric vehicles, right? So they have done this thing. And so government is trying its best, but the major issue is, government is trying to push FAME II scheme, but the major issue in that also is, in case of electric vehicles, see, the major issue is that people are more concerned about the range. Okay. And that too, it's not that the range is too low. If you see, the electric vehicles are coming with 200, 300 kilometers of range. Right. It is not about that. It is about the charging time. Right. The major issue is charging time. Right. People are more concerned about the charging time. And especially if you take the simple case of mobile phone, as soon as the battery hits 15%, we immediately start looking for the charger. Right. And we want to charge the battery immediately. Right. Although we have 15% of the juice left, but still we want to charge the battery. Right. So now incorporate that fear incorporate that ideology into the electric vehicle. So people are not afraid of being able to, like, after 200, 300 kilometers, the battery will discharge. They are more afraid the major hindrance is that what they believe is after 300 kilometers, it will take 4 hours to charge. Right. That is where the major drawback is currently. So for in India, electric vehicle to be successful, the major issue is of the charging stations or the charging infrastructure. That is the major issue. Right. People are ready to buy electric vehicle, but they are more afraid on the terms of charging. Right. And in that also, for those who have been living in Delhi NCR recently, like for last 15 days, I think you might have experienced heavy power shortages, like not heavy, but yeah, some power shortages are there. Continuous load shedding is going on in Delhi NCR, like for 15 days, right? So that is also one more thing that is a issue over here. So if you are unable to handle the load due to the increase in temperature, people are using more ACs. So if our grids are unable to handle that load, how will we be able to handle the load of charging stations, which will be charging vehicles, like which will be pushing 5 or 6 days of electricity of a household, equivalent to that much energy, into the vehicle in 4 hours or 2 hours, right? So how will they be able to handle that kind of load, right? So that is the major issue, sir, actually. So major challenges on the charging side for India and for around the globe, but Europe and all, they have tried, they have improvised their infrastructure accordingly and the companies are working there. But right now in India, companies still are very hesitant because people are more reluctant or people are more they are ready to buy two-wheeler. Currently, as per the sales segment also, people are willing to buy two-wheeler electric vehicles. but still they are hesitant to buy four-wheeler electric vehicle due to the cost and the charging. So that is it.
That means, sir, it will increase the load on the road also, no? Because I have seen that government promoted the people that you should not the diesel Vikram, you know, the public transport. You can go with electric vehicle, but nowadays I am seeing that the traffic has been increased. Not because of electric vehicle, because of incorporation of electric vehicle on the road, because people are using those things as an option only. Electric vehicle, yes, you are right that people are purchasing electric vehicle, but for a small segment they are purchasing. That means people are again basically attached to the your conventional vehicle. And I think, sir, from my point of view, maybe it will take next 50 years to fully convert conventional vehicle into electric vehicle. Because, sir, my area of interest, I am working currently in the area of biofuel generation. So that's why I was quite interested to know these things. Thank you very much for your presentation, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Can you please guide us to find good journal website to get current automobile journal? Sudarshan, actually, automobile journals, okay, let me do one. So I'll just write a message. So if you want to get updated to the industry, you can subscribe to Bloomberg if you want. So Bloomberg will give you the data and inputs regarding the whole industry in terms of sales and technology both. They are slightly expensive, but they have the most updated and most relevant reliable data, you can say. If you want in terms of market study or in terms of technological study, everything you can find over there in Bloomberg. Right. And apart from that, you have McKinsey Insights. Right. McKinsey Insights is free. Right. So there you can find not technological, but again, the market study. So so for us, actually, if you are looking for something in terms of research, so I might not be able to help you properly in the journals regarding that, because for last 2 to 3 years since I have been working, and especially when I went to consultancy part and all, so I have been more like I can suggest you regarding the market studies, like the market scenarios and all these things. So market insights. So regarding this, Bloomberg and McKinsey Insights, you can see. For India, you can have GMK Research. GMK Research is another one. This is also a free. They also provide free monthly reports. Actually, they will provide, okay, for each month in the second week of each month, they release the monthly report of the last month. Right. So right now what July is there, right? So by 15th or 16th, they will launch the report for June, the sales report and all the updated information, the market informations or the policy informations regarding the electric vehicles for the month of June. Then you can also find the quarterly report also there, like quarterly report, monthly report, and then yearly reports, all you can find in GMK Research regarding India and the world, right? So that is there. So these three I can suggest you, like, okay, not like if you want something from research point of view, so I'm sorry, I won't be able to do that. Sorry for that, because for last 4 years, my job has required me to look into this sector more.
Shall we have a 10 minutes break?
Yes, sir. Sure. We can have 10 minutes break, then I will continue with the next session. Yeah.
Oh, okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable and information presentation. Participants, kindly listen. Our final session will be 12:30 to 1:30 p.m. Then validatory function, 2:30 p.m. to 2:50 p.m. feedback by participants, 2:55 p.m. to 3 p.m. vote of thanks. Then 3 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. official Facebook entry in Atal web portal. Then finally, 3:30 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. online test in MCQ. Okay, so all of you will join 12:30 p.m. sharply. Thank you.